Now, we took the biggest gamble of all, which is, can we change? Can we be different and still be successful? If we had done it, if it had worked, we would have looked like geniuses, you know? But it didn't work, so we looked like fools.
Welcome to episode 9 of the Hipsters United podcast. My name is Chris, and this week is the third and final part of Jill, Andrew, and my discussion of all things Adore. We will return with weekly episodes in mid-June.
On Adore, we purposely sort of backed off the public aspect of it. We put more of our energy into the charity part of the tour, into trying to explain the musicality of the album, which of course, became an out-of-control monster that's inverted itself on us, and that became the story of the album, the failure of the album, or my madness, or whatever. So it became less and less about music and more about the failing of a band.
So let's spend some time talking about the short Adore tour. Before the album came out, the band announced that they were not planning a large tour to support the album, possibly another sign of a lack of confidence in public reception to the work, but eventually, they played for a little over a month at a series of interesting locations throughout Europe, the Far East, and Australia, including the Guggenheim in Spain and the rooftop of a record store in Paris. And I have a clip of Daphne Descends from Sydney, where you can hear both the difference in singing style from the Viper Room show, and you can kind of hear the early Adore Tour sound of the band. And rather than using the studio musicians that appeared on the record, the band used drummer Kenny Aronoff, keyboardist Mike Garson, I believe, also joined the band for that tour. And they originally hired violinist Lisa Germano, only to dismiss her days before the tour began. And listener Ethan wants to know if there were ever any concrete details released on the departure, on her departure right before the tour started. Do you guys remember anything?
Yeah, I was trying to search my memory of that, and I think that was sort of a mystery as to why that happened and what the story was behind that, whether it was Lisa couldn't handle the workload that Billy put on them, or if something else happened. And I guess it's not fair to speculate if the details aren't out there to be had, but probably I wouldn't be surprised if it was simply a case in point where Billy's standards were somehow a clashing point there, and decided to jettison her rather than to try to compromise some artistic vision that Billy had.
Well, and didn't she actually play with John Mellencamp at one point?
Yes.
Yeah. Well,
I just can't imagine that exact. I mean, she was like a fiddle player on his tour. So I just can't. I mean, I'm sure she's a fine musician by her own right, but that just sounds strange to me.
Well, according to her Wikipedia page, she's a multi-instrumentalist.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's kind of hilarious in my mind's eye, sweeping piano solo from Mike Garson into fiddle. I don't know. It's strange to me.
Well, based on her uncited Wikipedia page, which, I mean, if you can't trust that, what can you trust? She originally turned down the offer to tour with the band, but Billy convinced her that she would be more of a collaborator rather than just a touring musician. And I'm wondering if maybe she was just unhappy that it wasn't really turning out that way, and maybe Billy saw that she wasn't really happy and wasn't maybe, like, keeping up with just learning the material for the tour and just kind of let her go before. Like, he kind of saw that things would be unpleasant once the band got on the road and started touring. But we'll probably never know.
Yeah.
So someone go out there and find Lisa Germano and bring her on the podcast. We'll ask her. We'll be nice. Yeah, sure.
You will, maybe.
Yeah. Like when you keep up with the tour.
You're almost in a no-win situation when you hit a peak moment, because the public essentially just wants more of the same.
Well, once the band got back to the U.S., they played some unique tour dates here as well. And it was billed as an evening with the Smashing Pumpkins, and the band donated all proceeds to local charities, which ended up being, I believe, around $2.6 million. And the band also attempted to play some free shows, but only ended up playing one in Minneapolis, which attracted a prison escapee, amusingly enough. And despite the goodwill, like you'd expect to be generated by free tour dates and charity donations, the fan reception to these shows was decidedly mixed. As Billy had previously announced, he would be retiring all Siamese Dream and earlier songs and held true to his word during this tour. And I have a clip of For Martha from the Atlanta leg of this tour that we will play right now. So did you guys have a chance to catch an Adore tour date, and if so, what were your impressions?
Well, I saw, I believe it was the first American show in San Francisco. I think it was their, in fact, I'm pretty sure it was. It was their first show for the American end of their tour. And they, that particular night, they decided to play, they had sort of, and during the tour, they had a mix of sort of had different nights of different themes, and one of the themes was occasionally they would play all the songs from Adore during the concert, and that was what we got in San Francisco. And Billy actually had to get the liner notes. He brought out the actual liner notes from the CD of Adore out so he could sing Annie Dog, because he had. Apparently, and the practice they had on that song, and the lyrics hadn't been part of that practice, so he had to stand in front of the microphone with the liner notes in his hands and sing the song. And you know, like a lot of the shows they had during that tour, they had a official from the city of San Francisco come up on the stage during one of the encores, issuing an proclamation that the day was that today would officially, by order of the mayor, Willie Brown, Smashing Pumpkins Day, and thanking them for the charity, the donations, and so.
Man, they did that in Atlanta too. You mean that was rehearsed?
Yeah. So. I other than the I think the miss I would it was a overall a good show. I think it was a little odd that the Annie Dog, as I mentioned, was a little odd, and unfortunate that that song got played instead of something else. We didn't get one of the along this tour the jam song they did in favor of or in placement of Silverfuck was a Joy Division cover transmission, and we missed out on that one, and that was kind of a disappointment that night. But I went with a friend who was not a Smashing. I think he was a semi Smashing Pumpkins fan. He had Melancholy. I think he probably had Siamese Dream, but he wasn't like a guy who. Had I not invited him to go with my other ticket, he wouldn't have gone. And he was sort of he didn't hate it, but it wasn't all that. He's not impressed, I guess, would be the way that his perspective of the show was.
Yeah, I went to the Atlanta show on August 4th. That's been heavily bootlegged and passed around. And I was in a band in high school. We played Pumpkins covers and. Terrible original songs, and we were quite terrible, but we all went, and I got pretty good seats. I remember this was before you could order tickets online, really, or you could, but I didn't trust it at all, so I remember calling Ticketmaster the morning tickets were on sale, and I got tickets in probably the 13th or 14th row, so pretty close to the front, and it was in the Fox Theater in Atlanta, which was this, like, I mean, typically they have Broadway shows there, and it's got, like, the inside of it looks like maybe the inside of a castle or a monastery or something like that. So it was an interesting experience, like, to see the Pumpkins there, but it was kind of weird seeing them in, like, a theater seating type setting. I think the other Pumpkins shows that I've been to have all had, like, just standing mosh pit type areas, so that's kind of what I associate a Pumpkins show with, rather than, you know, everybody's in their seats and they're standing up, but there's, like, rows of seats in front of you. It was kind of like going to the orchestra, actually, which was pretty weird. But the other guys in my band that went, including my friend Jason, who I mentioned earlier, were all pretty unimpressed, like you said. Like, I think they were all expecting to hear, like, Cherub Rock and Today and songs like that, and they weren't playing them. And I knew going in that they weren't going to be playing them, and I understood why, you know, kind of, like, trying to make a break from the past and the whole Jimmy Chamberlain thing. But I think to the average fan who didn't obsessively follow them on Usenet, it was just like, well, you know, where's all the songs that I heard on the radio? Like, what is all this stuff?
Well, I was on the flip side of that a little bit, because I actually had seen the band perform in 98 on the Horde Festival. So in betwixt all of these Adore shows that they were playing, they did a few dates on John Popper from Blues Travelers Festival that he developed called HORDE, which stands for Horizons of Rock Developing Everywhere. I always joked that I don't know how you could really measure whether that mission has been accomplished or not. but they actually played sort of a stripped down, not as long a show, in Bonner Springs, Kansas, that did actually include some of the prior hits. There was Bullet with Butterfly Wings. They did play Tonight Tonight. They even played Through the Eyes of Ruby on that show. So they had, you know, they had the majority of songs were from the Adore album, but they had kind of delved a little deeper into their back catalog. But as far as that experience, it was quite interesting because I actually won tickets to the show, and they were quite good tickets. I'd called into the radio, and strangely, you know, I'd won two tickets, and then they sent me four tickets, and I was able to, you know, bring a few friends to the show, none of whom were really Pumpkins fans, but who appreciated actually going to a festival. And there were other bands that we had kind of wanted to see. Ben Harper and the Innocent Criminals played. The Bare Naked Ladies played. I actually watched the Pumpkins show with the lead singer from the Bare Naked Ladies because he sat right in front of us. He offered to sign my ticket, and I didn't have the heart to tell him, no, I don't really like your band. So I was like, all right, sure, here you go. I don't know who else asks if they can sign something, but whatever. So it was kind of a big mixture, and I think that what I remember most clearly from that show was just, like, all of these pop bands had come out on stage to perform, and the Pumpkins just come out, and the presence is so strongly felt. Like, Billy Corgan came out in the middle of the hottest part of July in an all-black, floor-length, you know, coat, to play this very dramatic show, and it was quiet, and I believe, you know, one of the songs that they played was just that really grandiose version of Tear with the Mike Garson piano solos. It was just so different than everything else that was being played that day, and it was, you know, it was beautiful, but it certainly was more of an audience that was enjoying John Popper's Blues Traveler. You know, it was a lot different, which I actually really appreciate having gotten to see them perform. John Popper is one of the only musicians in existence with a PhD in harmonica performance, so it was pretty phenomenal to see that. But the Pumpkin show itself was really good, though not well received by the audience at all. And I actually taped that show. That was the first tape I had ever produced, extremely poorly, via a handheld micro cassette recorder that I think I screamed. I think I screamed the whole way through. So yeah, don't track that one down, though it did help me get a lot of choice bootlegs because no one had any idea how bad that tape was before they got it. So
Yeah, as far as looking back on that tour, like, I still like listening to a lot of those shows in bootleg form, and I think part of that is just that we have so many, besides your microcassette tape, we have a lot of good soundboard recordings from FM broadcasts, like the Atlanta show was broadcast on the radio, and I know there were quite a number of other ones, so this was kind of unique in the band's history, where we have not only recordings of all the shows, but extremely high quality recordings.
Well, and there's some great video recordings that have actually, not surfaced, but been re-released to DVD or to digital format recently. That the concert you talked about earlier on the French rooftop at the record store, I actually watched that fairly recently, and they're great, but it's so strange to see the mood of the band, especially with how severe and kind of gothic James Darcy and Billy are compared to, like, the happiest drummer on the face of the earth.
Yes.
Like, I will never understand Mr. Aronoff, but he just always had a ball. Always had a ball. So I always wondered if he had, you know, a little bit of a problem. Like, how can a man be that happy all the time? But
I was glad they came out with another record, because if they wouldn't have, I would have felt terrible, you know?
The thing that moved me the most that he ever said to me about it was, when he heard the record, he didn't feel bad so much as he felt bad because he heard me struggling. And he knew that if he'd been there, that it wouldn't have been such a struggle. And that, to me, is the most moving thing that he said about it.
Well, looking back on the recording process and the tour, how do you guys think things would have been different had Jimmy still been in the band?
Are you trying to ask us to answer that same question that the official website wanted to know in their, like, writer's search?
Oh, did they? Honestly, I don't remember that.
That was one of the essay questions, yes. That was one of the questions that I'm sure they got plenty of really ludicrous submissions about, so. I think it's hard to tell. I mean, it wouldn't have been a door, I don't think. It would have been totally different. It wouldn't have been these songs. I don't know.
Yeah, I think the fair answer is that it wouldn't have been what we got. And certainly, I think one of the comments that Jimmy made later on when they reunited was when he heard Adore, I think he only heard it after it came out, that he felt like Billy was trying too hard. And I think that's a or something like that.
Yeah, I think he said Billy was struggling. He could hear the struggle.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, Billy lost half his main musical muse that he had been, you know, leaning on for 10 years up until that point. And, you know, I'm sure for Billy it was a difficult process to sort of get out the songs he had in his head without having Jimmy there. Feeding off him and playing, inputting his own take on Billy's ideas.
Yeah.
So it's a tough question to imagine how Jimmy's input would have shifted the album itself.
Yeah, I think that the sound of the album would have been a lot different. I think there would have been much fewer drum looping and much more live drumming, but, like, the way the band was at the time, I mean, it's really hard to say because something had to give. Like, it was almost like VH1 Behind the Music waiting to happen, you know? This band starts out as nothing. They grow and become more and more popular, more and more popular. I mean, the next step in that is something bad happens and they have to really take a look at themselves. So they were flying too close to the sun, so to speak, with all their past successes. But I think that, like, as far as the actual songs that were written, Billy was still having the same life experiences outside of Jimmy being fired and the drug problems there. I mean, like, with his mother dying, and I believe he got divorced around that time, too. I know that he's never, like, he's purposely not said anything about his personal relationships and things like that, but I think that was made public around that time. And as far as the production of the record goes, like, there was still, like, his career was expanding with his soundtrack songs and producing his own work. So I don't think it would have been a terribly different in terms of tone. I think that the live drumming probably would have added something that turned a lot of people off. It may have been a little bit more accessible to existing fans, but I still think there would have been that kind of that personal sadness to it under the surface.
And it may have been expressed in anger as well. I don't know. I mean, I think that Jimmy kind of enables Billy to express anger better. I think, you know, even if Zeitgeist is not a particularly angry album, I think it does kind of express that in more detail. But, you know, I think you're right, Chris, that he was going through the same experiences in terms of content. But you have to wonder what the outside of that would be. If he kind of had a different outlet. And it's interesting because the band had just gone through, in the songwriting period and the production period, the band had just gone through this huge high. You know, they had had all these Grammy nominations and all, you know, Fashion Awards came in 98, I believe, but all of these different critical acclaims and commercial successes, but all this crap was happening in his life that was, you know, personally affecting him. And whether it's a common life theme or not, I think that the content probably would have been the same, though the output a lot different. There's no way to know, I guess.
Yeah, I think that didn't Billy or someone or Jimmy possibly say that after Jimmy got rehired right before the Arising tour, don't they have some studio versions of Jimmy playing some of the Adore songs like as rehearsals for the Arising, or was that just a fan rumor?
I've heard that before, though I don't know how accurate it is.
I don't know if there's, you know, that doesn't seem like a very Billy thing to do, but I know I know that when Jimmy did come back, that then when they sat down to do Pug and Tear and some of the songs that they ended up playing on the Rising tour, that I'm sure they opened up new horizons in terms of how the song works and new opportunities for Billy to evolve the song. And that would never have happened if the Rising tour had continued to have Mr. Aronoff on the drums instead of Jimmy. Of course, certainly that would have never have happened. But
I know, but one thing, Machina would have been much more happy, I think, if if Kenny Aronoff was still around. I don't know about Jimmy on Adore, but Kenny on Machina definitely would have been very different. Well, we didn't get any audio feedback from listeners for this show, although we did get a good number of topic suggestions. However, we did get a recording from the vacationing Jason with his thoughts on Adore, so let's take a listen.
Jason, usually people accuse me of being too pro Billy Corgan or pro Smashing Pumpkins, and this is a good example of why that's not just totally always true, because I don't really like Adore. I thought the tour was really bad. I think the tour started out okay. I think it increasingly became bloated and ridiculous. The August 5th Atlanta show that many people love, and just one of the most commonly circulated recordings, I think is just atrociously bad. I mean, there's some moments, but the miss ratio is way bigger than the hit ratio. As for Adore, the album itself, I rarely listen to it. I had a hard time getting into it when I got it. It may just be that I need loud guitars, I don't know, but I think the songs are really good. Actually, at root, I think the Viper Room show is evidence of that. But their rendition on the album is, I don't know, it's just not very appealing. A lot of the B-sides are better. I like some of the outtakes a lot. They're a lot more fun. They're a lot more loose. But that's me on Adore.
So Jason's not here to defend himself, but what do you guys think of that, besides the fact that he got the date for the Atlanta show wrong?
It invalidates his point.
He's fired from doing the SKFC tour history. It's an interesting point he makes about the looseness of the outtakes. I think that's really interesting, and I had never occurred to me to really think of it in these terms. Adore does seem kind of stuffy. There are certain, you know, even some of the songs I like a lot on Adore, they have this element of very formal construction that fortunately doesn't necessarily translate to the live shows. But on the album, I definitely see that. You know, I feel like The Tale of Dusty and Pistol Pete, though I kind of like that song, is sort of an iteration of a Beatles-esque White Album song. Like, it's formulaic. But what I don't necessarily agree with him about is the tour. I think they were trying to do what, you know, I know for certain that Jason does not like Mike Garson, and he doesn't really like the sort of extrapolations that Mike Garson took on all the songs. It takes away from the music itself. I personally disagree. I really loved Mike Garson on that tour. I think that he added a lot. And furthermore, you know, I'm maybe what Jason is talking about is that Transmission cover. I love that cover. I think it was awesome. I wish I would have been able to see it live. It's really fun in bootlegs. But I don't know exactly if that's what he means by it being bloated. But, you know, if you're doing something experimental and something a little arty, you're taking a risk and you're going into uncharted territory. So, you know, for better or for worse, I think. But I do agree with him. It's not an album that I listen to all the time, but it's something that I can appreciate historically. And I think that I agree with him. The songs at their root are pretty solid, except for Annie Dog.
Yeah, I kind of agree with him on Mike Garson, although I don't think that it was... I think he actually added something to the Adore tour. I don't think that it really bothered me until the Machina tour, like his kind of keyboard extrapolations. I thought that for the most part, although some of the intros to Tear, I think, were just a little bit too long and flourishy for me, but I think that in a way it kind of added to the feel of the shows, especially when they were playing in these, like, the Guggenheim and the Fox Theater. It just seems to kind of fit the tone of the tour, but I can definitely see where he's coming from, and I think that there are quite a few fans that feel that way, and it's partially why this album was so polarizing and kind of lost the Pumpkins a lot of mainstream fans, I think. Well, this has been quite the epic show. We appreciate all the feedback we're getting both at hipstersunited.com and on iTunes, and I hope everybody enjoyed this little series of shows about Adore and a celebration of the 10-year anniversary of the release of Adore. We will return in mid-June to discuss the latest Smashing Pumpkins news and rumors. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Good night.
God bless you very much. Thank you.
The Hipsters United podcast is not affiliated with or endorsed by the Smashing Pumpkins or Warner Brothers with Freeze Music. All opinions offered by panelists or guests of the Hipsters United podcast are their own and do not represent the opinions of the Smashing Pumpkins. All audio used during the show is licensed for nonprofit use per the terms and conditions on the Live Music Archive at archive.org. Intro music is from the Machina 2 album released for free download on the internet by the Smashing Pumpkins in August of 2000.